Well, we are getting overwhelming response to Andy Basiago, so much so, I'm going to keep him for the fourth hour. So we'll be back with your phone calls, and those of you who were on hold and hung up, try to get back on. But we'll take calls with you and Andy next on Coast to Coast AM. Well, Andy, I have time traveled. I've gone into the future and yanked you back to the program. How are you?
Indeed. I had to teleport back to the phone, George.
Let me tell you something. The response is so overwhelming that I would not do justice to our listeners by only giving them an hour of phone calls with you. So we'll take advantage of this last hour. And Craig Hewlett was gracious enough, who just did a full show with me a week or so ago. We'll come back at a later date. But this entire project is incredible. Let's concentrate a little bit on Rumsfeld and Richardson. Rumsfeld, in my book, has created problems in Iraq and Afghanistan with aspartame and everything else. Tell me what you think his true involvement was with Project Pegasus.
Well, I know what his involvement was. He was the defense attaché. My father and I had substantial contact with Don Rumsfeld when we were on the project. He was well-regarded. And, in fact, he was at a phase in his career where he hadn't made all these controversial decisions. And so I think, to the extent that he's now a man in his mid-70s of advanced years, he has everything to gain historically by coming clean about this particular chapter in his career so that teleportation can literally be unleashed to advantage humanity. I mean, he's had a very controversial career. But in those days, he was a 39-year-old former congressman who basically had been appointed to a board that President Nixon had established and yet was secretly serving on this time space project. And so I think that Secretary Rumsfeld will want to come forward to be responsible for this particular chapter in the history of our country, in which we acknowledge the fact that we developed this technology.
How will you try to get a hold of him or Bill Richardson to at least come clean?
I'm going to write them letters explaining why I think that the highest form of public service would be represented by embodied in coming forward now and simply acknowledging that we developed teleportation. We kept it secret because, as Don Rumsfeld said in the talk that I was in that he gave a meet and greet in April of 71 at an underground amphitheater, sort of an intelligence committee briefing room, again in Cerritos, New Mexico. And he described how the significance of the technology was to allow the military to put troops precisely where they were needed on the battlefield. Well, he's now lived another 30, 35, 40 years in that realm of focusing strictly on defense matters. And I think yet he possesses the intelligence to recognize the fact that teleportation could be so much more. It could be the way that we literally get from, you know, Grand Central Teleport in New York City to Union Teleport in Los Angeles in a couple seconds. So I think that he has everything to gain historically and personally by simply affirming the fact that we did develop this technology and it has great potential, and that potential was not implemented because the technology has remained weaponized since Tesla's death.
When was the last time that you teleported? How old were you?
Oh, God.
It's been years?
I was. Oh, yeah. Well, let's see. In the summer of 1980, I had to teleport between a teleport near the Van Nuys Air Force Base in California, airfield, I should say, the Van Nuys Airport, and an area behind one of the labs in Los Alamos, because they found during my junior high school and high school years that I was quantum slipping. I was having experiences, let's say, where I was putting my books in my backpack in junior high school, and I could hear all the kids roughhousing behind me, you know, all the other junior high kids. And then suddenly I'd hear a ringing in my ears as the sound diminished, and I found myself standing there by my locker alone. So at some point between the time that I was marshaled out of Project Pegasus as an 11-year-old in 1972, and then we moved to Southern California, and my first year of college, the intelligence community, which obviously my father had remained in communication with, if not working for, determined that a quantum slipping was going on that needed to be corrected. And so they had me teleport from Van Nuys to Los Alamos and back to try to correct that. That had resulted from an episode at Sandia in 1971 when my father was supposed to get me through the teleport back to New Jersey by 9 p.m., but he became engrossed in a discussion with another engineer he met in the hallway there, And I finally ended up jumping through the teleport at Sandia at 9:02 p.m. And I don't know what the basis in physics is for what happened, but I somehow, the witching hour was actually 9 p.m. I was supposed to have jumped through the device 2 minutes earlier. And that created some kind of technical problem that they were trying to correct. So that was the last time that I teleported, was in 1980. Oh, well, on Earth. But then in 1981, in the summer of 1981, they had placed the CIA agent in my life named Courtney M. Hunt. And the question that he was plying with me the entire summer of 1981, you know, June, early July of 81, is, do you want to go to Mars? And I said, quite frankly, no, I don't. And so I finally relented when he explained, well, you have to go to Mars because the survival of human life relies on it or depends on it. Yeah. And I think by that he meant that we have to possess the courage to go off planet. So in any case, I did two jumps to Mars via a jump room at a CIA facility in El Segundo, California in 1981. And I think that was as a result of both the intelligence community wanting to acclimate me to Mars because they knew what my destiny was relative to the discovery of life there, you know, the natural history work that I'm about right now, articulating what's up there, but also simply because I'd been one of the kids who had served on Project Pegasus. So I haven't, since 1980, I haven't done any of these teleportings around the country like I did as a child, but there were several one-off jumps to Mars in 1981, and I don't think we have time to get into that tonight, but that's part of why I'm speaking out now, which is to reveal the fact that we've been using teleportation to reach Mars, and I don't think we should move forward as a civilization keeping such activities secret from the majority of human beings on our planet.
Interesting. Paul Gersio, who heads up the Merlin Project, which is a computer software program that predicts and analyzes timelines for the future, says that one of his clients is former Secretary of Defense William Cohen under the Bill Clinton administration, wants to know if you want an entree there. If you do, let me know. And he said he'll work on it. So that would be Bill Clinton's Secretary of Defense, William Cohen. Can he help you at all?
Well, if he can, I would certainly like to talk to him. I think that's a very generous offer. But, yes, I want to work through positive people in the political life of our country simply to achieve the revelation of the teleportation capability. This is as significant. It was when Tesla developed it, as significant as the achievement of air flight by the Wright brothers, as significant as the landing on the moon. And yet we kept it secret because a determination was made during World War II that this should be used as a weapon system. And it could be so much more than that. So if Secretary Cohen and other positive, progressive people in our political culture want to assist me in this effort, I would consider it a privilege to work with them to bring this to the attention of the American people.
All right, back to the phones we go. We'll pick it up by going to Jackie in Cherry Hill, New Jersey. You're up with us on Coast to Coast. Jackie, good morning.
Good morning. I would like to know if you see anything positive about the United States economy since China is becoming a little bit restless and they want to execute their lien on our U.S. Treasury.
Well, again, I've resolved not to become a prognosticator or soothsayer because the factual basis of the story is my 10-year investigation carried out roughly between age 38 and now 48 to go back and describe what happened 40 years ago. And so I'm not really in a position to make a set of predictions about coming events. I am an optimist, however, because I've been to the future, and it's a beautiful place to visit. And so I think in the long haul, the world that our children and grandchildren will be living in will be a very nice place to inhabit. And so ultimately, I'm an optimist. But I don't have the factual basis, in fact, to make near-term predictions like that because what I overheard at the dinner table 40 years ago was very limited. In fact, they were keeping from the children in the program most of the knowledge about future events, for example, that were being summarized in the kinds of intelligence reports that Don Rumsfeld and my father and other principals on the project were promulgating.
Though it's probably a different show, give me a highlight on what you think is on Mars.
Well, my paper, The Discovery of Life on Mars, is an analysis of a single NASA image, image PIA-10214, which was taken from the western edge. It's a westward view from the western edge of the home plate plateau in the Columbia Hills range of the Gusev crater of Mars. And what that shows is, as I described it in my paper, literally it's a cosmic treasure trove.